social entrepreneurs about how they're changing the transplant situation in China and the breast cancer situation in Nigeria and in Chicago. The papers are now open for discussion. I think what we'll do is take a sequence of questions. Please try and keep your questions short. The time is not as much as I had hoped, but we'll take a series of questions and then just get responses from Fumi and Michael at the end, and we will try and end close to noon to stick to our schedule. So if you come up to the microphone, anyone has a question or a comment they want to make.
This is more of a practical question, I guess, for you, Dr. Olapati, but some friends in Haiti want to bring cancer services, and they've already been given a mammogram machine, which sounds like the wrong option. So practically, what are you advocating, short of the bigger picture of genetic sequencing, what are you advocating for people right now to do to bring cancer services to low-income countries?
Oh.
Fumi, let's just take all the questions. We know that once Lydia asks the first one, then the torrent of questions breaks out because you've got to break the ice. Any other questions? We'll just take all the questions and comments together. Anyone else? Ira, fire away. Do you want a pen to write that down? Here you go. So please just take a note of the questions and comments, and then we'll ask you to respond to them all together at the end. That way we will be able to stick.
The question is for Mike. I'm Ira Codner from Wash University in St. Louis. Do we have the right to use any kind of a filter on the fellows we train in transplant surgery, raising the question of what they're going to do when they leave Chicago or St. Louis and go back to their programs?
Great, thank you, Ira. Any other questions or comments anyone wants to make to these two wonderful papers?
Hi, I'm Saba Ganai from University of Chicago. A question for Dr. Olapati on the BRCA testing and the cost of it and relating to patenting of genetic information and Myriad. Thanks.
Great, anything else, questions, comments?
Hi, this is a question for Dr. Millis. I'm Maya Seghetti from University of Toronto. I'm a transplant fellow. I just wanted to ask you about what you recommend or what you would advise on to low or middle income Eastern European countries who are now at kind of a brink of developing a transplant program based on your experience in China.
Thanks. Great. See, I told you once Lydia asked that first question, it just breaks open the stream. So. I don't know, Mike, do you want to go first or Fumi? Doesn't matter to me.
Sure.
Mike, so in about a minute, can you hit
those
questions?
Yeah, sure, I can hit them, yeah. So the first question was from Ira regarding training of Chinese surgeons who will go back to China. And the answer to that is that one of the foremost leaders of developing the ground operation for a deceased donor, voluntary citizen-based deceased donor program in China is from a Chinese surgeon who spent many, many years in England learning their system and then coming back to China and has really been an advocate. He is in Wuhan, Klaus Lee, and he's really been one of the big pushers and knows all the intricacies necessary for a deceased donor program. And so I look at that in the same way for our fellows. For Chinese people who come and learn transplantation in Chicago, if I can teach them how it's done correctly, ethically, system-based, et cetera, then they will be advocates for developing a similar type of system in China rather than continuing a system that we all recognize is unethical. So that's how I view that. Mark asked a question about the number of decreased prisoners. So there are the numbers of transplants has gone down significantly from close to 6,000 liver transplants done in the 05 era to around 2,000 now. And in addition, instead of 95% of the organs being from executed prisoners, it's now down to about 60%, with most of that being covered by living donors and a fraction by the growing, hopefully, system of voluntary deceased donor organs that we're working on. And then the final question was, what advice do I have to other developing countries? Part that I would like to use is China as a model in terms of developing a organ transplant system that from the very beginning has to be regulated. It cannot be done in an unregulated fashion like it was in China. But really developing those systems, that's why it's so important to get this voluntary deceased donor program up and going, that it's transparent and it's successful, so that can be the model for other developing countries.
Beautiful. Thank you. Mike Fumi, in about
a minute.
Okay,
so I think that really three main areas that we can act actively. So when the AIDS activists really got out and said, we've got to stop this, they focused on getting treatments to people who needed it. And in the cancer world, we have not done that. We've been so passive that it doesn't matter. So oncology pricing has been that we price drugs for 10% of the people who have cancer in the world. And we extend life with all of the treatments we get for 6 or 9 weeks. And those drugs are approved just to be marketed in the West. There's some real innovation that's going on. Brazil, for example, is making generic drugs so that cancer patients can get drugs that are affordable. And I think we can do this at a global level, not just for Novartis to get people access to Gleevec whenever they can get there. So diagnostics and treatment, we have to focus on that. I think the question about patenting, so, you know, Myriad patented BRCA1 and 2, that's one gene. There's a competition to see whether we can get the whole genome for less than 1,000 a day. And I can tell you, with the innovation that's going on in science and technology, we can get this test down to less than $30 per test. And the question is, how are we going to make sure that it reaches everybody? And what's the kind of business model that will sustain it? So I think that to really make a difference in terms of reducing inequities in cancer outcomes, we have to focus on prevention, and that's where risk assessment and policies can really make a difference. And then we have to do treatments and make drugs available and affordable to people who right now are suffering in low to middle resource countries. I think that's basically
excellent.
The question.
Perfect. So on your behalf, I'd like to thank these two social entrepreneurs for the work they're doing, and thank all of you, and Mark has...